If you started as a janitor at Microsoft in 1985 before the company got really big, you would have been able to retire 30 years early as a multimillionaire. In fact, it's estimated that Microsoft made over 12,000 millionaires just because they had access to private stock at an early stage. Now, if you break this down and really think about it, you have to ask yourself a question. What did all of these companies have in common? And the answer to that question is they were all in trending emerging industries. Microsoft was in the computer, you know, hardware, software industry at the right time in history. Amazon was in the e-commerce industry at the right time in history. And the truth is, if you're in a dying industry, it's gonna be like trying to swim against the current, and chances are you aren't gonna be successful. And let's say, even if you're one of the top employees at one of these companies that's in a dying industry, let's say you do something really amazing, like you're the top sales guy or something like that. You're gonna get like a 1% raise, or maybe you'll get like a $25 gift card or a pat on the head or something ridiculous like that. Whereas if you're in a company that's in an expanding industry and you do really well, you might get access to company stock options. You probably get a 5 or 10% raise, probably even more than that. And if you're in a dying industry and a dying company, they'll make it hard for you to do even basic things like requesting vacation time, accessing your benefits. Everything like that is going to be like pulling teeth because they're counting pennies. Like, you might find out that you have to apply to a vacation a year in advance, or they didn't mention this, but after starting the job, you have to wait a year before they start matching your 401k. And people who are in a dying industry, they're going to be watching this and they're going to be knowing that I'm telling the truth. They will fight you for every penny, every nickel, every dime. And let's say you're not an employee. Let's say you're an entrepreneur and you want to start a business in a dying industry. It's going to be the same thing. Making money is going to be like pulling teeth. Whereas if you're in an industry that's booming, there's going to be opportunity everywhere. If you're the type of person who wants to be an employee for the rest of your life, you can absolutely do that. You'll be able to retire probably 10, 15, maybe even 20 years early, as long as you're smart with your money. And let's say you're an entrepreneur, you're the type of person you want to start your own business. Well, there's going to be lots of different opportunities for you to go off on your own and become an entrepreneur and start a successful business. It'll be so much easier for you to ride the wave in a successful industry rather than swimming against the current in a dying one. So in this video, I'm gonna break down what the top five industries of the future are so that you can go where the money is and find success. So number five on the list is going to be genomics. So let me ask you a question. If you could make yourself smarter, if you could eliminate all the family history of disease that you have, like let's say you have type 2 diabetes or hypertension in your family history, and you could eliminate that, would you do it? If you could make yourself smarter, better looking, would you do it? This probably sounds like the movie Gattaca, but let's be real here, guys. It's gonna happen. It might not be in the next 10 years, but in the next 20, 30 years, it's definitely happening. So there's a new technology that scientists are working on right now, and it's called CRISPR-Cas9. And what this is basically a gene editing tool. And basically what this tool is able to do is the same way that a computer programmer can edit code in a computer program like software or your computer, this device is able to edit genetic code. And there's so many different uses for this. I mean, just think about it. You could take away diseases, you could make people smarter, you could edit the genetic code of crops so that, you know, different crops can grow in environments that aren't necessarily perfect. So basically, you're only limited by imagination when it comes to this sort of thing. And I think the technology itself is going to be here within the next 10 to 20 years for sure. The only question is it going to be legal? Is the government going to ban it? You know, that sort of thing. Healthcare technologies tend to be very slow moving just because it takes a while for them to get approved. So the next one on the list, number four, is going to be digital currencies or cryptocurrencies. So I think everybody's heard of, you know, Bitcoin, Ethereum, etc. And there's a lot of like really scammy stuff going on out there, like people creating cryptocurrencies, you know, cashing out on them and then just exiting, you know, creating ICOs, that sort of thing. And there's just a lot of shadiness in this industry overall. But the reality is there's some truth to what these people are saying. You know, digital currencies are going to become a thing. It probably won't be Bitcoin, maybe not even Ethereum, just because that technology is not as advanced as some of the ones that are coming down the line. Might end up being, you know, Libra by Facebook or something like that. I'm not a cryptocurrency expert. I'm not gonna say which one I think it's gonna be. But the reality is the industry of currency is just a little bit messed up right now. I mean, have you ever gone traveling and you try to transfer your money into another type of currency? It's a huge pain. It's just a huge pain. And anybody who's gone traveling will know that what I'm saying is true. It's extremely inefficient. There's so many different middlemen that take their cut, you know, credit card companies, banks, etc. They're all taking their cut out of your money. And the answer to these problems is cryptocurrency, digital currencies that are designed to run in a world without any intermediaries. That way you don't have to rely on a middleman. And there's so many different uses for cryptocurrencies, like smart contracts or microtasks. There's a lot of completely legitimate uses besides just transferring money. And this is another one where we're gonna have to see what the government says in terms of how fast this is gonna be adopted, but it's definitely gonna be huge in the next few decades. Now you're probably noticing a lot of the ones on this list have, you know, two things in common. They're either related to health or tech, and the next one is related to health, and that's personalized medicine. Sorry if my handwriting is horrible. I hope you can actually read that. But yeah, this personalized medicine, it is closely related to number five on the list, which was genomics, but there's some differences here. So for instance, an example of personalized medicine would be a toilet that automatically analyzes your poop. Sorry to be gross and bring that up, but yeah, toilets that would like automatically analyze your poop, tell you like, hey, there seems to be something wrong. And maybe it analyzes your pee and it's just like, hey, there's a lot of protein in your urine. You should probably go to the doctor and get that checked out. You could intercept diseases like cancer, etc., at a much earlier stage so that you'd have a much greater likelihood of actually curing it. Another example of this would be like maybe a patch that you could put on yourself that could analyze your heartbeat. Maybe later on it could even take small blood samples and tell you what different labs are gonna be. Again, this is gonna be another huge industry that's gonna come up in the next 20 to 30 years. If you go into an industry that's related to health, it's pretty hard to go wrong. Of course, there's a few exceptions to this, but health and technology, pretty hard to go wrong if you go into one of those two industries. All right, the next one on the list, number two, is going to be augmented or virtual reality. And this one is one of my personal favorites. I absolutely love this industry. There's so many uses for augmented and virtual reality. Now, before I get into that, let's break down the difference between augmented and virtual. So virtual reality is basically where everything you see is generated by some kind of computer or software. It's basically where you would put on some kind of headset of some sort. You might be on like a treadmill where you can walk in all different directions, and everything around you is going to be like a video game. It's going to be like in the movie Ready Player One, and that's definitely where video games and all that sort of thing are heading. And then augmented reality is where part of what you see is the real world, and part of what you see has been generated by, you know, the glasses you're wearing or the headset that you're wearing. So a really basic example of that would be kind of like Pokemon Go, where you're looking through your phone at a Pokemon that's not really there, but you're, you know, it's generated on the screen and it looks like it's there. So imagine the different things you can do with augmented or virtual reality. So for instance, let's say you're trying to train somebody how to do kind of a complicated task. Sometimes even maybe a task that's dangerous, where the training is actually extremely dangerous. So for instance, you could train a surgeon how to do an extremely complicated surgery without them having to mess up over and over again and people actually dying before they learn how to do the surgery correctly. Think about sales, for instance. I have a background in sales. So, you know, if you keep on getting the same objections over and over again, you could make a program where the person in front of you is giving you an objection saying like, oh, I can't buy this because, you know, my husband doesn't want me to, or something along those lines. And then you could practice saying what you would say in real life and overcoming that objection. There's so many different uses to augmented and virtual reality. Seriously, the sky's the limit. This is going to be a huge industry in the next 30 years. Now, before I go to the number one on the list, I do want to mention the ones that almost made the list. And honestly, any one of these could potentially be top five. This is just my opinion. You might think like, oh no, this one that didn't even make the list should have been number one. And that's totally cool. That's your opinion. That's cool. 3D printers, driverless cars, wearables, drones, cloud computing is another really big one. All of these are going to be huge. And again, you probably noticed some similarities with these. All of them are kind of related to either health or technology. If you go into health or technology, you're going to be pretty golden. Like, you're going to be good to go. I really think that health and technology are the two best to go into. Obviously, you want to find something that you're passionate about within those industries. But if you want to start with kind of a top-down approach, health and technology, look into those. And this doesn't matter whether you're planning on being an entrepreneur or an employee. There's going to be a ton of opportunity in either of those industries. All right, the moment you've been waiting for, number one on the list is going to be artificial intelligence or machine learning. Now, I know that technically these two things are a little bit different. I don't want to get blasted out there, but just for the purpose of this video, I'm trying to keep things very simple. You look at the biggest breakthroughs throughout history. We're talking about steam power, you know, creating trains, that sort of thing, electricity, the internet, hardware. You look at the biggest breakthroughs, the next biggest one is AI. This is the next frontier. This is the future. You look at huge companies, Google, Facebook, all these big companies in the tech field, they are all doubling, tripling, quadrupling down on AI and machine learning. People who specialize in machine learning are making a lot more. You can ask computer scientists who work at these companies, who's making the most money? Even entry-level guys. It's the guys who are learning machine learning. People are getting entry-level jobs because they specialize in machine learning, 200,000 or above. A lot of the people who work at these companies, when you factor in the bonus, the stock options, the base pay, the guys who are making the most money, even just going in like entry level positions, are the ones who are specializing in machine learning. And I know that some of the other ones that I mentioned, like the health related ones, they might be getting big, like, you know, a decade from now, just because there's a lot of regulations and that sort of thing. This one, it's happening right now. We are on the edge of a golden era of AI and machine learning, and this is gonna take over the world, for better or worse. You wanna have a really, really good chance of getting rich as an entrepreneur, or even just as an employee, this is what you wanna get into, AI, machine learning. All right, guys, so I hope you enjoyed the video. Again, these are all just my personal opinions. You might disagree with me. If you do, comment down below. Maybe I missed one, maybe I'm off on this, and if I am, I will remake the video. Okay, guys, smash the like button. Subscribe to the channel, comment down below for more videos like this, and also check out these videos here because I am going to be uploading some really good ones. Other than that, bye for now and have a good one.